Hello guys, good evening. Hello guys, welcome. Good evening. I'm Mohit, your host for today's alumni lecture. I hope you all are safe and enjoying our orientation program. Stay tuned with us because we have lots of surprises planned and which are awaiting for you all. On this special evening, we have very special guest with us. He's an amazing inspirational personality, bureaucrat of our country. He's Mr. Vishnu Venugopal, and production department engineer of batch 2009. Who cracked the most coveted and the most competitive exam of India, the UPSC Civil Services Examination, and secured All India rank 34 and joined Indian Administrative Services in 2012. But before we begin our Q&A session, I would request Kalpana ma'am to, I would request Dr. Kalpana Narayan, Alumni Affairs Consultant, Alumni Interaction Cell, Office of Dean, Institute Development and Alumni Relation to welcome our guest and address students.
So, hello everyone. Good evening. It's a pleasant surprise that we have Mr. Vishnu Venugopal with us. Thanks a lot, boys, for this beautiful evening. Well, I'm Dr. Kalpana, representing the Office of the Dean of Institute Development and Alumni Relations. I am a consultant with that office. Incidentally, I'm also an alumni of this institute, so I took my postgraduate degree in 96 from this institute. So I'm very happy to have Mr. Vishnu here. Thanks for joining in, and Vishnu, I've heard lots about you through multiple channels, and we are actually having you on the list to address our alumni and the institute for in another forum called the Alumni Cast. So thanks a lot for joining us, Vishnu. So welcoming all you boys. Mr. Vishnu, am I audible?
Thank you, Dr. Kalpana, for the warm introduction. And thanks, Mohit, for the connect. Am I audible?
Yes, you are very much. So nice, Vishnu. Thanks a lot for joining in.
Yes, my pleasure. So, are we good to go?
Thank you, ma'am. I am proud to introduce Mr. Vishnu Venugopal to you all, who is an alumnus of batch 2009 from Production Department. He started his career as a risk analyst after graduating, and later in 2011, he was selected for prestigious and challenging Prime Minister Rural Development Fellowship, and later passed civil services examination with All India rank 34 in his very first attempt and joined the IAS in 2012. As a civil servant, he has served as a sub-collector in Chennai Mahadevi, Tirunelveli district. He has been an executive director at Chennai Metropolitan Water Supply and Sewerage Board, CMWSSB. He was also an officer on special duty with Ministry of Shipping, Government of India. He is currently serving as the collector of Tirunelveli district, Tamil Nadu. Just about 3 weeks ago, he got transferred there. His contribution to Manthiyur Tirunelveli by bringing in electricity, water, roads led to it to be renamed as Vishnu Nagar, aptly named so by the villagers. Vishnu sir holds a certification in port management from Belgium and project management from IIM Ahmedabad. He received the Young Achiever Award in 2017 from Excellence in Public Administration and is also a recipient of Eisenhower Fellowship. I welcome you, sir.
Mohit, thanks a lot for the warm introduction on a Sunday evening. Thanks a lot.
So, sir, you have recently transferred to the Tirunelveli district. How has your experience been there till now?
I'm just 3.5 weeks old. So,
yes, sir.
Welcomed me with an alert for Nivar cyclone, followed by Burevi cyclone. Last 3.5 weeks have been pretty much a high adrenaline rush week, but fortunately, cyclone was expected to pass through the coastal parts of our luck might have it that it didn't.
Yeah.
First 3 weeks has been extremely, I would say, exciting. looking forward.
Thank you, sir. So can we straight away dive into the Q&A session?
Oh yeah, definitely. First of all, before that, let me tell you, it's a matter of great pride and privilege for being invited by your alma mater. Every time there's a pride and privilege for me that the college invited me to this orientation session this time. And really excited to meet young boys and girls who've just this is a rather tricky year. You have a completely online session, I believe. But nevertheless, it's a pleasure to meet. Luck to all of them. I wish them that they've taken the right choice. That note, I thank once again.
Okay, so. So the pleasure is all ours. We are honored to have you on our orientation as an alumni lecture lineup. The pleasure is all ours. So, sir, the first and the most obvious question that everyone have is what inspired you to choose IAS as a career option? After graduating, you would have lots of opportunities in front of you. But what made you choose IAS as your career option?
Yeah, so I think this question has often been asked to me. Why the IAS? Because let me be very honest on that front. That the IAS or the government or any of along those lines was not in the scheme of things. Just like every other average NITTN, my options were yes, definitely a good job. 4 years of and I did get a good job. I was working as a risk analyst on corporation in the US. And for pretty much 1 year, I was very happy and satisfied with my work. Profile was good. The regular expectations of a good job, everything, every definition met the expectations. So it's all looking good. But somewhere in the back of my mind, there was a nagging feeling that maybe this is not what I wanted. I wasn't sure. Maybe very honest. I was not sure what exactly I wanted. But somehow, I was sure that this is not what I wanted. I wanted something else. Now, what that something else, I wasn't sure initially. Just like every other engineer's dilemma, we have three options. One is the CAT, then comes the GRE, and third is entrepreneurship. And I passed out in the year. I can hear comments that the voice is breaking. Am I audible, Mohit? Am I audible, Mohit? Am I audible?
Sir, you're audible, sir.
Yeah, because I hear comments. I can see the comments that the voice is breaking, but I believe it's okay, right?
Yeah, it's fine, sir. It's fine, sir.
Yeah, okay, great. So, just like, the dilemma I was mentioning about whether it was a CAT then or the GRE or, in between, I thought maybe I should try to do dabble with entrepreneurship, but I wasn't sure. And that was when... But one thing was certain. I did not want to be in the corporate sector. I wanted to do something which was impactful, something which was had a direct impact. And that's why I zeroed in on a few options. One was definitely starting my own social entrepreneurship venture. Second was the civil services. And let me be honest that I have not met a civil servant before I cleared the IAS. There's nobody in my family who's in service, or I not even remotely connected with an IAS background. So I've not met an officer till I clear the exam. And that's how, given these options, I thought, yeah, it makes sense to give a shot. And that was when the UPSC announced that they're going to revamp the complete syllabus. And for the first time in 2011, UPSC has brought what is called the aptitude test. It consists of more of a CAT type examination that they introduced, and I thought I had a good chance of cracking it. So it was a pure practical decision that I had chance of cracking this exam. But at the same time, I started reading more on civil services. I started exploring on what are the career options, and I found it to be fascinating, especially with the fact that you could work a lot on rural development and be an active part of the nation building process. I think that excitement was good enough for me to jump into this whole arena of civil services, and not been looking back. In the meantime, I was fortunate enough to have been selected for a fellowship called the Prime Minister's Rural Development Fellowship. That's why, then that brought me closer to the government, and I understood that, okay, you can make a lot of impact being in the government. It was more of a trial and error method that I ended up in the civil services. It was not a planned decision while in college, or for that matter, earlier in school. This is a very honest story about how I ended up. Yeah, Mohit.
So your voice is breaking the place. If you can this where it is, so it would be better.
Mohit, I think your voice is. Am I audible? Because I've been told by. Okay.
Yes, sir.
I can see somebody commenting that my voice is moving as a sine curve.
Yes, sir. You're audible, sir. You're audible, sir. Great. Mohit is having a connectivity issue. He'll be back in like a minute.
Yeah. So I think one of you can shoot a question.
Yes, sir.
And I am Ahmedabad respectively. So sir, can you please tell us what are the avenues of IAS? Can you just bear us for a few minutes because of bad network, which sir has left the call. It will take just a few minutes and we'll be back with Vishnu sir once again. So guys, Vishnu sir will be back because of some network issue. He's not in the call, but he will be back. But we have with us Raman sir, Dr. S. Raman Sankar Narayan. He is the dean of alumni relationship. So he will address you.
Hello, Raman sir. You can like unmute yourself, sir. Hello, sir.
Good evening. Is it my turn to speak?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Vishnu sir is having some connectivity issues. Until then, we can have an introduction about. Hello.
Good evening. Raman here. Am I supposed to speak now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah, you are supposed to speak now, sir.
I thought alumnus guest Mr. Vishnu was addressing the gathering.
Yes, sir. Vishnu sir is having some connectivity issues. Until then, you can address the issue, sir.
Good evening to all of you. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You're audible, sir. You're audible, sir. Raman, sir, you're audible, sir.
I thought Mr. Vishnu was addressing the gathering. Am I interrupting him?
No, no, you're not interrupting him, sir. He has some connectivity issues. So he has logged off. He will be back in few minutes. Until then, you can address the event, sir.
Okay. What we are speaking is now going on the line. Is it live?
Yeah, is it live, sir? It's live, sir.
Oh, okay. Okay. Thank you. So good evening to all of you. I take great pleasure. It gives me great pleasure to welcome all the students for this session. And a very, very warm welcome to our alumnus guest, Mr. Vishnu, IAS, and a special thanks to all the student volunteers associated with the alumni office who have been kind enough to organize this program. I myself had some connectivity issues. Only after 6:10 p.m. I could join, and I am also staying connected on and off. Bear with me. For the benefit of the students, let me say a few things as we are looking after the alumni relations office. This institute that you students have joined this year, is not only a very high-ranking academic institution in the field of engineering and technology, it is also what I would say a very happening place. A lot of things happen here, and the students are dynamic. The faculty also try to contribute to their best of their efforts and the best of their abilities. And a lot of events are organized in campus. Only thing is this 2020, due to peculiar situation, you are getting connected online. But once you come to the campus, you're really able to feel the vibrancy of the campus. One of the most exciting places in the academia. And in addition to regular transactions that take place in any academic institute, what we excel is also the extensive handholding that takes place between senior students and the new students, and also the extensive and committed handholding that takes place between our highly accomplished alumni and our very talented students. So these connections bring a lot of life into the campus, sensitize the new students about various opportunities. You get to know a lot of things. It is not only the equation that you are getting to know in your thermodynamics class or the microstructure that you are studying in your metallurgy class. You get to know a lot of things, lots of opportunities. The campus tries to really open your eyes and ears. So please be on the lookout for a variety of opportunities. And I myself am a faculty in the Department of Metallurgical and Materials Engineering and on International Relations. I would say most distinguished alumni across academic institutions. You name it, we have it. You are looking for somebody in a really high-profile technical institution, Caltech, the California Institute of Technology, the Dean of Engineering, or what they call the Head of Engineering Division, an alumnus from NIT Trichy. You look for faculty in some management schools in US and Europe, you will find alumni of our institute. You search in the grid for very prominent CEOs of very esteemed organizations, Tata's, Birla's, TVS Group, wherever you go, you would find that some of our alumni occupy really the top positions. And in addition to academia and industry, our alumni also have an enormous commitment to the society. So if you look for persons who are serving the government, for example, like the Indian Administrative Services, assisting the government of India, you find quite a few talented and committed alumni from our ranks, including the speaker of today evening, Mr. Vishnu, IAS. You look for defense services, you would find a very good number of brigadiers, air marshals, rear admirals, vice admirals, so on and so forth, from the ranks of NIT Trichy. For example, the very first batch, the alumni who graduated in 1969, the very first batch, two alumni rose to very high positions in the defense services, including a vice admiral and a lieutenant general. In the government services, such as the IAS, we have people at the level of secretary to governments. That is, secretary level is considered to be one of the very senior positions in the government hierarchy. So there also we have our alumni. So our reach is enormous. And many of our alumni have not only reached positions of eminence, but they're also passionate about whatever they are doing and bring a lot of vibrancy into the community. So we have great alumni, great accomplishments, and great contributions to the society. So with these words, I welcome Mr. Vishnu once again. I believe Mr. Vishnu is getting connected. Do I see you on screen?
Yes. Yes, sir. I'll just connect the camera in a while. I have a small network issue. But am I audible?
Mr. Vishnu, I'm very delighted to have you here in this forum. Please
thank you.
Your experiences with the young kids.
Definitely.
Who have just
Definitely.
Joined your alma mater. And on a personal note, I extend you a very small, special welcome, as you have just taken charge of Tirunelveli, right?
Yes. Yeah, that's right. 3 weeks ago.
Yeah, I belong to Tirunelveli. And
okay.
I gather that within the last couple of days, you visited the heritage home of Dalavais in Tirunelveli town.
Okay. Okay.
We have connection from our school days with Mr. MDT Kumaraswamy. So it's a small world.
Okay, okay.
And you are doing an excellent job trying to contribute
thank you.
In whichever way you can.
Definitely. So, Mohit, am I audible?
Yeah, sir. Yeah, you are audible, sir.
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Yeah, Hamid, I think you can go ahead to the next question if you have. I mean, I'll connect as soon as the network is slightly better. I'll connect with the video part. I think we can.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, sir. So, sir, our next question is, you have done lots of things. You have Eisenhower's Fellowship, Prime Minister Rural Development Fellowship, certifications in sport, port management and project management from Belgium and IIM Ahmedabad, respectively. So, sir, can you please tell us what avenues are there to reach IIS?
Well, I mean, the kind of opportunities that you get once you join the IIS is unparalleled. Right from you know, an opportunity to go study at the Harvard University, Lee Kuan Yew at Singapore, or you name it, any of the best universities in the world, the IIS gives you an opportunity. Definitely not in the initial years, but you know, you put in a few years of service and these opportunities come to you. Apart from that, professionally also, in many of our assignments, we get the kind of international exposure. I was fortunate enough to work with Government of India early on in my career within the first 4 to 5 years, and that took me to Belgium, where I was given an opportunity to attend one of the best port management courses in the world. Apart from that, the Eisenhower Fellowship, which I happened to receive early last year, it took me to travel to the US for almost 2 months, including the Harvard University. So all these avenues come to you as an IIS officer. It comes with the roles that you take up. Based on your interest, based on your aptitude, these are all avenues that come to you. So I think to cut the long story short, the IIS is all about diversity. And it's just not about the local exposure. It's also about world-class international exposure. Even for the training for the IIS, we have the Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy of Administration in Mussoorie, where you know, I'm top-class experts such as Abhijit Banerjee and Esther Duflo, the Nobel Prize winners, they teach the courses through JPAL and MIT. So these are the kind of exposure that we get, and right from our training days in the IIS, which I think is truly world-class.
Thank you, sir. The Lepsna, which is a dream place for all the aspirants who are preparing for the IIS exam. Yeah, so there are many things which we can do after we get into IIS as well. So the next question is, how was your experience at NIT Trichy, which helped you while serving at your job? So what was your experience?
Yes, sir. I think the moment I stepped into NIT Trichy, my career was made, I believe, in a lot of ways. One is the pre-assigned credibility that one gets with the tag of NIT Trichy. Every single forum that I go today, before the IIS, I'm introduced as an alumnus of the prestigious National Institute of Technology, Trichy. I think that the tag of NIT Trichy has brought a lot of leverage in every platform, right from my IIS interview to my first job in the corporate, then the Prime Minister's Fellowship. Time and again, I figured out that the last a decade, 2009, I passed out in 2009, from 2009 to 2020, the repeated reference to NIT Trichy is giving me a lot of pre-assigned credibility in terms of the quality that they attach with the work that I do, the expectation that they have out of my work, professional front, or at, you know, specifically engineering related projects. They assume that, okay, I am from an India, so I understand engineering, I understand complex systems. So this comes with a lot of advantage for me. And what did I learn from NIT Trichy? Yes, for the first time I saw a mini India. I had a roommate, I had four roommates, two of them from UP, one from Uttarakhand, and another from Bihar. That's a mini India, and myself from Kerala. So I don't think no other place I've before that I would have seen a mini India. A student fresh out from my 12th standard, that gave me the first exposure to what I believe is important in terms of diversity. NIT Trichy introduced me to this whole concept of diversity, cultural values, varied cultural values, the whole campus life, and especially the hostel life for the 4 years that I stayed at NIT Trichy. I think that was a defining moment till this day. I hold those memories close to my heart. I think all of you have joined this first year engineering undergraduate students. I think the next 4 years is going to shape your, not just your professional life alone, but the way you look at the world and society in general. I think I've got a lot of 4 years of my wonderful campus life.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. It is very well said that NIT Trichy offers us diversity, where we get a chance to interact with lots of new people coming from different parts of the India. Yeah, NIT Trichy is also mini India, which we can see. So the other question is, many students are not sure whether the IAS exam is for them or not. What factors should they consider while taking such a decision?
Well, I think, like I said in my first question that you had asked, whether how did I come to the IAS? It was not a pre-planned decision. It was not something which I aspired for while in school or college. It happened to me out of various other circumstances. But for somebody who needs to seriously consider whether I should take up the IAS examination or a career in the Indian Administrative Service, or for that matter, any government service, you have to ask yourself, the first question, am I interested in the nation building process and the country itself? Am I a keen observer of the society? And is there a burning desire to be a part of it? If the answer is yes, then yes, the IAS fits into the scheme of things. If the answer is no, I really don't care. When I say care, this, I'm not attributing a positive or a negative connotation to it, but I just don't really care about what happens around me. I really don't care how the society is. I need to build a professional life on my own, or I need to build, become a world-class aerospace engineer. If that is your aspiration, perfectly fine. But if the answer to any of these questions is yes, then I think you need to seriously consider civil service. When I say civil service, it's just not the Indian Administrative Service alone. There are other services also which are equally important. The Indian Police Service, the Indian Foreign Service, Indian Forest Service, Indian Revenue Service. These are all pillars of the government, and they do very important activities in very senior level. You get a chance to be part of the government at very senior levels at a very young age. And if any of this interests you, the general society, and you want to be an active part of it, I think that's the moment when you should decide, yes, I have a potential to be part of the civil service. I think that's the takeaway forward. The second part is, how do we crack it? Cracking is just the second part of it, where just like any other competitive exam, you need to understand what the exam is all about. All of you have cracked the JEE, and when I was there, it was the All India Engineering Entrance Exam, or the AIEEE, I believe now it's totally through the JEE. So all of you have cracked a very prestigious examination. So just like this, civil service is also another very challenging examination. Second part is, clearing the examination, that I wouldn't say is very difficult. But the first part is important. The burning desire to be part of the nation building process. So I think that's my take on the overall factors that need to be considered while civil services.
Yes, sir. It is very well said. Means once you have decided what you have to do, half the race is done. So half
exam
the
is just another exam. I mean, civil service is just another exam. That's all. The first part is important. Do I want to be part of the system?
Yeah. So first ask yourself those questions. If you have, if the answer is a yes, then go for it. So in Manthur, when you were posted there, you brought electricity, food, and water. As a result, villages there renamed it as the Vishnu Nagar. So can you please share your experience? Like, how was it? Means, can you please share the experience what you did there?
I think, honestly speaking, it was a bit embarrassing. It was actually very embarrassing. But on a positive note, I was happy that if you do genuine work, people appreciate you. I mean, everybody likes to be appreciated for the hard work you put in. I think it brought into light a lot of things which otherwise I wouldn't have learned. Because, see, I served almost 2.5 years. I was in a very remote part of Tirunelveli, and at times you work in a magical, mystical land where you, which is not your you're not familiar with the terrain initially. So slowly I found that people were looking up to me for, you know, action. They wanted action on the ground. And I'm happy that I was able to deliver. I wouldn't say I was able to deliver 100%, but I've tried my best of my ability to solve as many problems as I could in the 10 years. And the appreciation and acceptance by the public, I feel, is the most rewarding than any other. You can't quantify it. The love and affection of people is something which cannot be quantified. Public.
Yeah, so.
But on the naming was a bit embarrassing. That's my honest take on it.
So naming, you feel it was embarrassing, but you have solved problems of people who were facing since many years. That's a great
thing. The government has thanked me for that. So it's just part of my duty. There's nothing more to it.
Yeah, sir. Thank you, sir. So the next question is for all those aspirants who are very close to deciding whether the IIS is their calling or not. But they have an appreciation in the fact that if they start their preparation, the preparation will require 1 to 3 years, 1 to 3 years, which has the potential to leave blank in their resume if that doesn't work out. So, sir, what do you think this appreciation is? So, how do you think this appreciation is being evaluated, and how it should be evaluated?
Like I said, the first, that there are two parts to it. One is, do you want to be part of the system? The answer is yes. Then comes the preparation stage. Well, preparation. Let me be very upfront on it. Today we live in a very we live in a world where information is available. Earlier, let's say a decade or probably 20 years ago, to prepare for the civil service examination, somebody had to go to Delhi, somebody had to go to Chennai, or, you know, difficult preparing simply because of the lack of information. Or simply because there was no available materials or information to prepare for the examination. But today we are looking at a very, very different world. Everything is available. The whole apprehension that, or the myth that it takes 1 to 2 or 3 years to prepare, nobody can clear it the first attempt, I think it's totally founded. It's not true. I have cleared it the first time, and not just me. A good number of them I know have cleared. Now the catch here is, how do we crack it the first time? Because this exam is like an enigma. Not many people understand this examination. Not many people understand the government itself. So I think you need to do your background work before even starting to prepare for the examination. Like, what are you getting into? Number one, the duration of this examination is long. It takes almost a year for the examination process to complete. You write your prelims in April this year. The mains happen somewhere around November, December. Then there is an interview around March or April the next year, and the results comes out by May. Which means you're in for a marathon. You're not in for a 2020 cricket. So you need the kind of stamina for that. You need the kind of endurance for that. Unlike a cat where you write the examination, you get the results in a month's time, and you join the IIMs in a matter of next 3 to 2 months. It's a long, long, long marathon race. Which means your peer group support, your family support, it's sum total of everything. So I think you need to understand the nature of the examination more than the content or what book to study and how to study, where should I go to study, whom should I refer to. Before all that, the fundamental question is, have I understood the requirements of the exam? Have I understood the requirements of what the career holds good for me? These two are important more than the actual preparation, because actual preparation is like, you know, cracking the code. It's just like any other examination. Get the first two right, and the third key is very simple.
So basically, understanding the requirement of examination is necessary if you want to crack the IIS exam in the shortest period of time.
Smart work. I would say it's smart work.
Okay, so smart work. Okay, so greatly put. So this brings me to my next question. So what do you think the UPSC Commission is looking for in an aspirant who is preparing for the exam, in mains as well as in interview?
Like I said, there are three stages. One is a preliminary, then there is a mains examination.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Interview stage. The preliminary is more about elimination, because close to 8 to 10 lakh people apply. And you really can't evaluate 10 lakh people. So what is expected is you weed out the non-serious candidates. So it's a process of elimination. So the bulk of the candidates get rejected at the first level. The next around 10 to 20,000 people may go to the next level, depending on the number of vacancies. So in those 20,000 people, let me tell you, most 50% of them are almost of the similar caliber. You wouldn't find great variation in terms of the caliber or the potential. Every one of those 20,000 candidates have the potential to clear the examination, very clear. So what makes a difference? What makes a difference is, number one, how have you understood the examination and how exactly you're going to express yourself in the mains. Mains is all about, you know, writing skills. It's about putting your thoughts in a very, very, very clear and concise manner. It's about understanding a lot of information and processing it and putting it out in a very lucid and understandable manner. It's about, you need to take one optional subject also, one of the optional subject out of a list of almost more than 50 subjects. You need to master that particular subject. For example, I took geography and public administration. Those times there were two optional subjects, one optional subject. To make it very simple, mains examination is all about how much have you understood, and it's more of a knowledge testing platform, and also your communication in terms of writing and expressing your ideas. Once you're through with that, roughly around 3,000 odd students get selected for the interview stage, which is held in Delhi, New Delhi, around the month of April. Interview is basically a test of, you've been tested for your aptitude, you've been tested for your subject knowledge and your understanding on various issues. So definitely there's no more checking on the knowledge part of it. The third stage basically looks at your presence of mind, your leadership qualities, are there any biases inside your viewpoints, your ethical standards. These are things which they check for the interview. So it's basically not called an interview. It's called a personality test. Who you are needs to be evaluated by the commission. Third stage is almost identification of who you are. And in that stage, it's all about being honest, being clear on your views without bias, abiding by, or at least having views aligned with the constitution of this country, because we run on based on not based on any other whims and fancies. So these are the attributes which are being checked for the interview stage. Broadly, I think,
yes,
to summarize the whole story, it's about aptitude in the preliminary stage, your understanding about the various subjects and various issues in the main stage, and finally about your personality for the interview.
Okay, so thank you, sir. It means the understanding of concept is important, and in personality test, you have to be honest with the panel as well as to be yourself. So thank you for those kind of advice. So the next question which we have is, it's been nearly 6 to 7 years, more than 6 to 7 years, you have been into the services. So sir, all this year, what keeps you driven and excited about your job?
Well, it's been 8 years, so I think specific things. I can exactly say. I mean, this question is something which I keep wondering to myself. What is it that keeps me driving? Three specific things. One is scale, impact, and diversity. The scale of working for the government is unparalleled. Kind of challenges. For example, my earlier assignments. One of the assignments included part of the Chennai Metropolitan Water Supply Board, which means essentially looking at water supply and sewerage management for 85 lakh citizens of Chennai. That's a mammoth scale. I mean, I don't see any other profession giving that kind of a challenge at a very young age. The catch here is you get these opportunities at a very, very young age. At the age of 25 to 26, you are a sub-collector. At the age of 28, I was looking after the water supply systems of Chennai. I think the scale is unparalleled. Second is the impact. You may not be able to change everything overnight, because India is a massive country. Challenges are so complex. It's not that you can solve everything overnight, but still, there is a lot of impact. Every signature that you put is impacting somebody's life. There is a clear impact on every file that comes to me, every single petition that comes to me. There is a life in it. So I think the impact is immediate. The repercussions or the outcome of my decisions are immediate. I don't think let's say compare it with some other profession. Teaching. I mean, you need to wait for a year for your children to clear the examination, right? Here it's impact. Impact is straight. If somebody doesn't have water supply, yes, I give water supply. I'm duty bound to do it. I'm not glorifying the fact, but the fact that you can see an immediate result on your actions is something phenomenal. And third is the diversity. I cannot think of any other profession that takes you through so many different verticals of professional exposure. Scale, impact, and diversity, to put things short.
Scale, impact, and diversity. These are the three reasons which keeps you driven and excited about your job. So the next question is, when we talk about media influencing, we see IS are portrayed in a poor light, especially with the transfers. People somehow believe that the corporate job is more lucrative, not because of the perks, but because it has less political interference. So, what's your take on this?
Like this, every profession has its own occupational hazards. Okay, so I have worked in the corporate, and I mean, maybe not in a very long time, but at least a year to get a feel and sense of what's in store for me. Even in the corporate, it's unfair to say that everything is black and white and there is no influence. It's there everywhere. But coming to the government, to the very specific question on influences, or I think we have signed up for it. We don't work in a perfect world. We work in an imperfect world. In an imperfect world, every decision is in shades of gray. And I think government is a representation of the complexity of the society. On that note, I feel the transfers and all come with its own, like I said, diversity. It's okay. I can get transferred once in 2 years. It gives me exposure in two different sectors. And there is enough work and enough opportunity to change in every sector. It's not that everything is okay in this country, right? Work in whichever department they put me in. And I think the whole notion that this is a good posting, this is a bad posting, not right. There is enough work, there's enough challenge. There is enough impact that can be created in whichever sector that you are. I don't think I worry about that much. It's just one of the occupational hazards, just like every other profession.
Okay, so every other job has some glitches. IS also has some glitches. It is how you see, in which dimension you see. This is what matters. This is what matters. Yes. So the next question we have is So when you talk about politicians, we usually look at everything from a pessimistic angle. But we also recognize that they are the ones who have the pulse of people better than anyone else. So can you share any real example where the politician acted as a catalyst in completing any project successfully?
As bureaucrats, we work closely with the politicians, because ultimately government is... We are an elected republic. We are an elected. We are a democracy. So, people's rule that happens here. On that note, let me tell you that I have been fortunate to work with really high impact politicians. I wouldn't want to name them, because that would be the point is not about naming or somebody's name specific. But the whole point is that politicians understand the pulse of the people. They know exactly what's happening on the ground. More than any expert, more than any bureaucrat, they are the ones who face the public every 5 years. Let's give it to them on the front that they understand the problems of the society. Now, what the question here is, how much can they deliver? I mean, people think that you become an IAS officer, you can change everything. Similarly, you think if you become a politician, you can change everything. So, ultimate outcome is an interplay between the government, the public, the external actors. So it's not just not a straightforward answer, right? And there are politicians who have done phenomenal work on the ground. They've done especially on natural resource management. I would specifically name one of the MPs. who recently passed away. He has done phenomenal work in his constituency in Tirunelveli. A lot of work on water management, creating basic infra at the rural front. Because the problems reach to the politicians first, more than faster than it reaches to the bureaucrats. Because connect with them, the public is much higher than. They are also part of the system, just like the good, bad, and the ugly. In every system, there is a good, bad, and ugly in politics too. Just like there's good, bad, ugly in the bureaucracy also. It's not like similarly good, bad, ugly in the corporate sector too. So we just need to take it in that sense.
Okay. So thank you, sir. Thank you for that for answering that question. So there is one more question regarding corruption. From since childhood, we are hearing that most of the government officials are corrupt. So, sir, how correct is that notion? Is there really a need to do corruption in the government, or it is the influence of the seniors who force us to do so? If seniors are forcing us to do corruption, sir, what consequences can we face if we do not listen to them?
Good question, because I would term government as a black box. Nobody really understands what happens in the government. What is happening? How is the government running? I mean, as a layman or as a general public, nobody really understands the functioning of the government. Neither did I. I mean, till I joined the government, I was clueless on what's happening. Frankly, I never knew how decisions are taken, how are they implemented, how are they measured, what is the feedback loop to the government. Let me tell you one thing about the Indian Administrative Service. We are appointed by the President of India. The Indian Administrative Service has a constitutional guarantee. Unless you do something wrong, there's no way you can be penalized for any of your activities. That constitutional guarantee is there. There is nothing that stops us from standing or upholding the constitutional values. There is absolutely no reason why you should bow down to pressure from anybody, for that matter, whether it's a senior, external factor, or whoever it is. If you are having 100% conviction, if you know what you're doing exactly as per the constitution of this country, as per the rules and regulations, as per the statutory guidelines laid down by the government, I think there is absolutely no fear of, there need not be any fear of having any repercussions whatsoever. Like I said, at the max that can happen is a transfer. At the max, what can happen is a transfer. Like I said, there's enough work in every department. But beyond that, if you are true to your actions, I don't think there's anything that you need to be worried about.
Okay, so it's totally dependent on us whether we indulge ourselves into corruption or not.
There is absolutely.
So if our ethics are right, if our morals are strong, then we will also remain uncorrupt. So
I told you that I'm again harping on the fact that constitution is what guides the entire country and constitutional values is what guides civil servants also.
So the next question here is how is the career progression of IAS officers? Means first a person who cleared the UPSC and is selected for the IAS, he's appointed as sub collector. Then he begins to he becomes IAS of a collector. So sir, how is the career progression of IAS officers, and what opportunities does one get in the services?
So what happens is you clear the examination and then you are called for training at the Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy of Administration, which is situated in the beautiful hilly town of Mussoorie in Uttarakhand. So there we undergo a training for almost 1 year and 9 months. In the meantime, it's a sandwich course. So initial 6 to 7 months at Mussoorie, then come back to the district where we are posted as assistant collector, and then we go back again for a training, short training, 2 to 3 month training in Labasna. It's called Labasna in short, which includes a foreign attachment also. So I was fortunate to go to Singapore, where we are trained by Singapore Civil Service College. And after the end of training, you are declared permanent in the service. You are posted as sub-collector. Next 1 or 2 years, you will you'll be posted in a very remote part of the country as a sub collector and a subdivisional magistrate, where you basically have exposure to land matters. And, you know, basically, the custodian of land is government. You look at land records, you look at law and order, you look at the basic functioning of a village office, taluk, basic functioning of the government at the grassroots level. After which you move to a little bit exposure on development roles. You look at rural development, you get exposed to smart projects like smart city projects, urban management. You could even have a stint in the headquarters. In Tamil Nadu, it will be in Chennai. For example, after sub-collectorship, I had a stint with water management in Chennai. So you get a bit of an exposure there. Then you're posted as district collector. So I'm now back as district collector in the district, which is probably the defining post in the entire career, because that is the most visible posting in the Indian administrative service. Everybody knows a district collector. Nobody knows before and after what you do, but everybody knows a district collector. Then you serve in the district for another 2 to 3 years. Then you move on to senior positions. You become joint secretary, and finally you go to the secretary to government of India or the state government, where you are actually making policy. You are shaping the destiny of the country in many ways. In the meantime, we have exposure to go abroad also. We have options to pursue our higher studies at Harvard and, you know, many of those. We also have opportunities to work with international agencies like United Nations. So it depends. After the collectorship, basically you can decide your career, which path you want. So this is the entire, assuming you get in at the age of 24, 23, you have almost close to 36 years of service in the government. You retire at the age of 60. Provided you don't resign in between.
Yeah, okay. So that is basically the brief career progression once we are into the IS services.
I'm trying to make it as short as possible.
Yeah. No problem. So the other question is, what role does an IS officer play in policy making? Does he the one who makes the policy, or does he the one who implements the policy, or the amalgamation of both? Does he do the detailing of the policy? So what basically is the role of IS in policy making?
Very good question, because everybody assumes that when you say policy, I mean policy, there's multiple levels. One is policy at the state level, then the policy at the national level. Initial 10 to 12 years, you don't really be part of policy making. You're only implementing the existing rules, schemes, and so on and so forth. But after that, when you're a mid-career bureaucrat, let's say in the seniority of 15 years, you are involved in the process. You understand how policy is being made. But at senior level, then you move on to the 20-25 years. I think a lot of policies are shaped by IAS officers. There is a lot of potential. Secretary level officers basically decide. The future. Senior levels, yes, they're actively engaged in.
So after, so as the career progresses, we get involved in policy making.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. So sir, next question is about the cadre allocation. We know how difficult it is to get home cadre as well as getting any neighboring cadres. Many aspirants have their fear in their mind, what if they don't get any home cadre? So sir, what kind of advice would you like to give them?
You have opted to come into the service because you don't want a 10 to 5 job. You're looking at something challenging. You're looking at something which gives you a kick, which something going, you're motivated. I mean, these are the basic attributes, and you have an interest in the country. You're not interested in your hometown. Like I said, I very clearly said, you have to be interested in the country, India. You need to be interested in society at large. I think if you're parochial in your outlook in terms of saying that, okay, I want to be posted in my hometown, or I want to be posted in my home district, I mean, you can hope to get there, that's okay. But if you're the person who's going to get dejected, okay, they've put me in Nagaland, I can't go there, then I don't think civil service is the game for you. Let me be very upfront on that. I think you basically opted to be in the service to it's the Indian Administrative Service. It is not Tamil Nadu Administrative Service, or it's not Andhra Administrative Service. So when the moment you say it's the Indian Administrative Service, you should be willing and ready to go anywhere in the country. That's the beauty of IAS. Otherwise, there is no difference between state service and the IAS. The beauty is that people from all over the country work in different parts of the country. It has a very binding force for the unity of the country. A lot of things are easier because there are other cadre officers, other native officers working in the different states. You don't need to get bogged down. If you're the person who is getting too much worried about postings, then I think the IAS is not really the game for you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir, for that answer. So we all know that IAS officers are straightforward thinking, no-nonsense type of attitude, and they're always solution-oriented. So, sir, what do you think are the qualities of an IAS officer which we as a college student can also start developing in ourselves from college days onwards?
I think every job requires, I mean, it's just not the IAS officer who requires the forward thinking, no nonsense. Any job you take, be it a teacher, be it a lawyer, be it a doctor, you need any of those attributes. But probably a slightly different kind of attributes which an IAS officer, over and above this, because these are all non-negotiables. These are all professional attributes that you require for any profession, any career. There's no second thoughts about it. The challenge in the IAS is that you need to take quick decisions in shades of gray. You need to work in a very, very bounded manner where there is a lot of asymmetry in information. How do you take decisions in those kind of situations? I mean, that is the kind of attribute or professional qualities that you would want as an IAS. The other problem-solving abilities, those are all non-negotiable. I think that is what we should try developing from college. And I think I was fortunate enough to be part of Pragyan and, you know, organizing committees. Our college, NIT Trichy, offers you ample exposure. Let me proudly say that Pragyan, which is our tech fest, is one of the best in the country. And being part of the organizing committee of Pragyan will keep you very good stead for your professional career too. So I urge that all the freshers, you know, take active part in all the activities in the college. Be part of everything, because your campus life is not just about studies or your CGPA. It's all about how much you've learned and unlearned yourself in the 4 years of college.
Okay, so we can say that if you're part of if you are active in college and taking part in all the events, in taking part in clubs and teams, whatever you will be learning there, then that will definitely help you while serving at your job.
Absolutely, absolutely. There's no second question.
Thank you, sir. So, this question is regarding the lifestyle of an IAS officer. Mostly, IAS are posted into villages, but in corporate jobs, we get to live in the metro cities, and we have little or rough idea about what kind of lifestyle we are going to get when we will go into any corporate job. So, sir, can you please throw some light on, like, what kind of lifestyle we are going to get when we get into any services?
I think you got a first-hand taste of what is in store where my network keeps going. So, I think this whole show itself gives you a kind of indication as to the kind of places that we work right now.
Yeah.
Part of my generator on.
So, sir, we'll get into the next.
Pardon?
So the next question, sir, here is in the last decade. Hello, sir.
Yeah, go ahead, Mohit.
So the next question is, sir, in the last decade and in this decade, we have seen the charm of IAS officers, in the charm of IAS and the services are decreasing in comparison to what it used to have in 90s. The recognition is that it used to have in 90s when we compare it to this decade, the charm is decreasing. In the coming decades, will IS keep dominating the other career option and even the best career choice for the Indians, or will there be any other profession or career which can emerge that can dominate IS?
It's a bit unfair to say that, you know, this is the best career choice, this is the best option, or only way to serve the country is by joining the Indian Army. Every career, like I said, comes with an occupational hazard. For example, I would rate teaching as the most challenging profession in, among all the career choices. Being a teacher is something which is, I think, is phenomenal, and not everybody can be a good teacher. On that note, your specific question on whether the IAS is losing its today's context, maybe the question about whether we need to have a generalist or an expert, that will continue to go, whether a generalist will be a better for the country or a domain knowledge specialist. But I think the Indian Administrative Service, at least in the short term, there is a resurgence, and there are a lot of people, professionals especially, who aspire to join the Indian Service. Even in my own batch, there are people who have had 6 to 8 years of corporate experience and they quit their jobs and joined service. Many of them are from the IITs, and many of them from the NITs. We even have AIIMS doctors joining the IAS. So I don't think the charm per se is losing. Maybe perception-wise, there could be a difference of opinion. But otherwise, I think if people who still feel that I need to contribute to the society and I need to be part of the nation-building process, I feel Indian Administrative Service offers ample opportunity.
Hello, sir. Hello. Your voice is slightly breaking. Can you move closer to the mic, please?
Am I audible?
Yeah, right now you are.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, Mohit.
Can continue. So it all depends upon what means. It all depends how people interpret it.
Absolutely. Like I said, it's just one of the good career options available to be part of the nation building process.
Yeah. So, sir, most of the, we are getting comments like ask questions regarding the preparation strategy. So, sir, age to start preparing for the IAS exam, and what strategy they should have during their college days, like what kind of approach they should use in college and start preparation. If they're starting from college, what strategy they should have, and what is the right age to start the preparation?
See, if somebody is very clear that, okay, fine, my career is, or my career option is to join the Indian Administrative Service, and you want to start preparing from college, then I believe third year is the ideal time. Because college, like I said, it's once in a lifetime opportunity, and it's just not academics alone that matter, whether even to clear the examination or for your future. The first couple of years, I don't think you need to start preparing for IAS examination per se. Maybe you can keep yourself updated. When I say updated today, the kind of medium available for keeping yourself updated is, now it's all on your fingertips. You don't even need to read a newspaper today, because live feeds keep coming, and there's a lot of available content in online media. Just keep yourself aware of what's happening in the country as well as across the world. Probably by the end of third year, you can actually seriously look at preparing from the examination point of view, so that immediately after your fourth year, you can write the examination, crack it the very first time. So it makes sense to start preparing at the end of third year. Look at how the pattern of the examination, because the whole charm of the Union Public Service Commission is they make the examination very unpredictable. So we don't know how the pattern is going to be in the next 4 years. They could change the pattern, but the essence of preparation still remains the same, where you need to have an interest in the Indian economy, Indian politics, world affairs, history, geography, anything to do with the country in general, the society. What's happening around you in terms of development in the technology sector. So it's a sum total of, just keep your eyes and ears open. But on a serious preparation note, I think probably if you start at the end of third year, that'll be an ideal way to proceed with it.
Okay, so we can say that first decide whether you want to do preparation, whether you want to do preparation for UPSC or not. Spend your maximum time thinking about that question. Once you are clear, then you can start at the end of third year, you can start seriously preparing for the exam and open your ears and be aware of what is happening around the surrounding.
Absolutely.
So that way, we can summarize it. So, sir, the final question for today, if you were to come to NIT Trichy in order to convince a few people to join Indian Administrative Service, what would be a few things that you would tell them?
Well, first of all, I wouldn't try convincing anybody, but I would definitely try to give a sneak peek into what is the service all about, what is the government all about. I would try to kind of demystify the government, try to make them aware, make the students aware as to how exactly the government functions. So I think that would be my kind of interaction that I would love to have with the students. Because personally, I used to hate advices while in college. I never liked anybody giving me advices. So I believe that I shouldn't be giving advices to anyone. But at the same time, I'm also duty bound to expose the students to what are the opportunities in front of them. And most importantly, we are in the midst of probably the biggest humanitarian challenge mankind has seen, probably since the World War II, the COVID time. And clearly there's going to be a before Corona and after Corona. Hopefully we should see an after Corona BC and an AC, and after Corona soon. I think if I were to harp on 2 points, which I would like to express, is that it'll be compassion and empathy. Because what this COVID scenario has brought, or what it has made us realize, is that compassion and empathy are two attributes in which the fundamental pillars of society will have to be built on. We might have technology, we might have great ideas, but everything goes for a toss if these two fundamental pillars are missing. And the fact that all of us, at least in your first year, that we're all communicating over an online medium and not face to face. Last couple of times I had come to college, it was an amazing experience talking directly with the students. The fact that today we are able to communicate only online shows that the compassion, empathy needs to be the two driving forces for the years to come.
Thank you, sir, for that answer. That's really kind of you. Any final words of advice would you like to give to all those students who are listening to this?
Well, I think enjoy your college life to the maximum. Make a lot of friends, and look at, don't jump into conclusions as to this is a good career, this is a bad career, or this is what I want in the beginning. Be open to ideas. Also, we have a lot of experienced faculty in our college. Talk to them and keep talking to different alumni so that you get an idea of what's happening around the world. And don't be shy to ask questions. Keep questioning, be it on the academic front or be it on the general front. Keep pushing yourself to your maximum limits, and be active all through the 4 years in college. Don't sulk and focus only on the academics front of it, because at the end of the day, nobody really bothers you about your GPA. I don't even remember my GPA, grade point average. Nobody will talk about your GPA 10 years down the lane. The only thing that you will take back is a handful of memories, and so ensure that you have a great and a vibrant campus life the 4 years you're in college. Be looking to come to college as early as possible. And good luck to all of you, and keep interacting on and off whenever we get the opportunity. Thank you for the opportunity, Mohit and team.
Thank you, sir. Means the APJ Abdul Kalam also said the same things, like, it is not what grades matter, it is the memories which you make that matter. So thank you for those advice, sir. So we will be now taking some few questions, because there are lots of questions
definitely
we are getting in the comment box. few questions we'll be taking. So the first question we have from Veda Sri. Sir, even I want to be an IAS officer. I wanted to know how you manage the newspaper and magazine study part, and do you think preparing from first year will give us an edge? Also, how was the exam day?
Well, let me tell you very bluntly, preparing from first year may not give you an advantage. Like I said, the examination pattern is a bit unpredictable. When you say that you're starting preparation from the first year, you're preparing for something which is 4 years ahead. So I think, like I said, just be aware of it. Keep yourself updated with newspapers. Don't get into serious examination kind of preparation from first year, because we really don't know what is in store at the end of 4 years. So don't get into that trap, because you will miss out on your campus life if you start preparing from first year, because the whole trend is that, you know, you spend hours together. All that is not required. These are all very conventional notions of preparing for the civil service examinations. It's not required. I would say third year.
The third year end is ideal. First year, don't get into serious preparation.
There's no harm reading newspapers and all that. But don't start looking at, you know, question just papers.
Just keep your ears open.
Yeah.
Be aware of what are the things which are happening in the country. Thank you so much. So the next question we have from Vedasri. Sir, how was the one year of preparation before the exam? What were the challenges you faced and how did you overcome them?
Like I said, the basic challenge will be in understanding the nature of the examination, because I don't think there's any other examination of this kind in the world. You need to write for 27 hours. There is the preliminaries. The prelims is for 3 plus 3, 6 hours. Then there is a mains exam where you have to like keep on writing for 27 hours, and that's a marathon run. And how do we write for 27 hours? I mean, it's very difficult. You need to get prepared for understanding what is expected, and how do we create that endurance. And also, like I said, your family and friends are also important, because for 1 year, assuming that you quit your job, and or if you're straight out from college, you give up your placement and then preparing for the examination, there's all kind of pressure from outside world that, okay, why it's better that you get settled in life, and these kind of questions keep coming to you. So you need that mental strength to keep all that away and say that, look, I have confidence in myself. So creating that confidence in yourself is very important, more than the subject matter. See, subject, all of us are, I mean, the moment you've come into NIT Trichy, it's very clear. You have the basic intelligence to prepare for the examination. That's a given. So the question is no longer about whether I know more than the other person. That is a given fact. That's just the very, very trivial part of examination. It's more about the mental strength that, and more importantly, if you don't clear the examination, there's a plan B. Be prepared for a plan B, because at the end of the day, it's an examination. An examination you could fail or pass. So you should not get dejected that, okay, I did not clear the examination. So I'm not good enough for this. I'm not good enough. I've got many of my friends who are, you know, much more brighter than me, but they failed to clear the examination for various reasons. You need not get dejected by that. So have a plan B also ready in terms of your career track or whatever it is. I think the mental strength is important.
So the mental strength is important for overcoming those challenges. Challenges will be there, but if you are mentally strong, you will definitely overcome them. And plan B, backup plan, is also equally important. So, sir, the next question is from Amala. Sir, which is the best for an IAS aspirant, NSO, NSS, NCC, were you part of any?
Honestly, I don't remember which I was part of. I think I was part of NSS. Like I said, see, these are all trivial. Whether you're part of NSO, NSS, NCC, it really doesn't matter. Whichever interests you, you should join for that. You should not go in the direction that, okay, if I join NSO, that's going to give me an edge into the IAS. No, if you like NSO, you join NSO. If you like NSS, you join NSS. Which is why I said don't start getting the trap of preparing for the examination from first year. First 2 years, just enjoy your campus life. Be part of the campus, not the IAS or the government. I mean, that can come later. So the straight answer to your question is, it's irrelevant. It does not really matter which of them you're part of it.
So basically, in the interview stage, nowhere we are required to mention which team will be part of NSO and
NCC. No,
so it doesn't matter. Whatever is, yeah, okay. So we, the next question we have is, so what kind of advice or suggestion you'd like to give to students who want to crack civil service exam?
Okay. I think I've already mentioned this, but maybe for the sake of...
Yeah. So we have already mentioned. So the other question that we have, so here is, so how to start? So what is to be our mental preparation before starting our IAS preparation on our first day?
I think, okay, that's a very good question because I said mental preparation, or he's asking me, what is your mental preparation? That's a good question. I think it's very simple. I mean, you're in for a long race. Even if you lose, you shouldn't take it to heart and, you know, kind of think that this is the only career option. I have many of my friends who felt that, okay, fine, I have not cleared this examination. I'm not good. I'm good for nothing. Or they get into bouts of severe kind of, you know, self-questioning their worth and things like that. You just need to treat this as one of the many career options available with you. Don't over-glorify the fact that, okay, fine, this is the best career option. You should be grounded in the fact that, yes, this is one of the available career options. If I get it, well and good. If not, there are 1,000 other avenues in today's world. Be prepared to take any of those.
Thank you, sir, for that answer. So it was great talking with you, like great conversation. We learned many things. The advice which you gave, we will definitely look forward to implement that in our life. Thank you, sir, for all kind of thank you, sir. And thank you, a large thank you to, like, from your busy schedule, you take some time out and you interacted with us.
Thank you, Mohit, and thank you, team NIT Trichy. And good luck to all my fresher juniors. Have a great time at NIT Trichy. Thank you.
So at the end, Kalpana and Raman sir wanted to give thank you speech to you.
Sure.
So thanks a lot, Mr. Vishnu, for the wonderful interaction. Honestly speaking, the entire hour and a quarter, it's been an eye-opening in many aspects, and not to mention your simplicity to communicate right from the heart. Thanks a lot, Mr. Vishnu. On behalf of the Alumni Institute Interaction Cell that functions with the Dean Institute Development and Alumni Relations, we had Dr. Raman, our Dean, welcome you and the gathering. Thanks for being willing to visit the campus. It's indeed going to be a pleasure for us to coordinate your visit here. From the AIC, we would like to have you soon in our campus. Also, we would like to coordinate some more activities and interactions with you, for which we'll get in touch with you. Thanks a lot, Mr. Vishnu.
In fact, the day I was about to be transferred, I was planning to come to your college. I was actually in Arialur, so.
Okay, so it would have been a real surprise then. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mr. Vishnu. Thank you.